Yeah, hey Rich, how you been?
Not too bad. We've decided to come out of our shell a bit and show our faces in this one, so we apologise if any are offended.
You're not quite centered there, Rich. I don't know whether you want to move your camera on.
I'll get my camera set up. Sort of got to go back to front with these sort of cameras.
Hey, you're looking beautiful, mate.
How's that?
Excellent.
All right.
So we thought we'd get together today just to introduce Rich's new compiler, and I'm going to take the role of the newbie, and Rich is going to take the role of the expert, and we're just going to walk through the whole process, and I'll be asking questions, hopefully the questions that you as a listener are asking, and we'll see where we end up with this one. So take it away, tutor.
Excellent, Fred. All right, I'm just going to start sharing my screen. So previously on one of our YouTube presentations, we talked to you about the ATS Trade History Generator. So this was a piece of code that Fred had developed for our members that is inserted into either the outputs generated from Strategy Quant X or the outputs generated from our in-house staged workflow process. And what this therefore does is it formats the trade history in a method or in a format that allows us to quickly import that into this database. So the reason we are now offering this, I'll just switch screen now. I'm just going to go over to our compiler. So the reason we're offering this exclusively to our members is that they'll be the ones who'll be able to get direct benefit from this because they use those workflow processes. So
Excellent.
look, the way we use the portfolio compiler as basically a one-stop shop to save all of our outputs generated from our workflow processes. Now, as our members would be fully aware now, it's quite easy developing trend following systems. And with the workflow processes that we go through within our forum, they're spoilt for choice in this vast array of different strategies that can be utilized within a diversified trend following suite. But one of the problems is, as a quant trader like we are, you really need to be very organized in the way you store this information, because otherwise, as we've found in our experience, is that when you developed hundreds of these different strategies, it's very easy when they're flavor of the day to focus on them and then park them somewhere in our file management system and then never return to them again. And this is a problem. Because some of these systems that we've generated might be still very applicable today. So we need some method of storing in a very organized way all of our workflow process outputs that allows us to retrieve them at a later date to see if they're still valid or not.
So,
Fred, thoughts on that?
Rich, this compiler is more than a compiler, then it's a database of all previous EA results.
Exactly, Fred. The way I view it, it's a bit like discretionary traders talk about a trade journal. I view this as effectively a trade journal for systematic traders using algorithms. It allows us to store all of our results so that at a later date we can come back to them. We can reuse them if necessary. We can reevaluate them. But it's always in one central repository that's very easy to access.
Okay, so the only bit of software you need is Microsoft Access.
That's right. So if you've got the Microsoft Office Professional suite of tools like MS Excel, Microsoft Word, that usually comes with MS Access. Provided you've got that as your database engine, this particular portfolio compiler works within that context of MS Access.
Okay.
So the way we've constructed this portfolio compiler is from a top-down method. In other words, we start at the top level, which we call our systems list, and then we go to the individual strategies that are contained within our system list. Then we go to the trade history contained within our strategy list. And then the fourth level here is the compiler itself, which we can explain a bit later. But I thought we'd start looking at the systems list. It gives people an idea of how to start organizing and storing their outputs generated from their workflow processes. So when I click into the systems list, I've got seven particular systems identified here. The first four relate to the outputs generated from our in-house ATS specific workflow processes. And the way we've structured this is that we keep all of our CFDs together. So when you're in Pepperstone and you look at the market specifications of each instrument, it tells you effectively if they're a CFD or a Forex instrument or an index or whatever. You use that as a basis to classify your systems into groupings. Now, each of the different groupings often have different position sizes within the market specification. That's why we tend to cluster them into these groupings of common lot size in their market specification. So I've got CFDs here, I've got my cryptos here, I've got my Forex category here, and I've got my indice system category here. So there are four different staged system outputs which I basically classify within these groupings.
So I can add as many different systems as I like.
Exactly.
As many. How do I create a new one?
So all you do is if you want to create a new system category, let's say this is your discretion. You might actually keep some of your discretionary systems in here or other systematic systems. So let's say we've got a mean reversion category. So we might call it mean reversion. And for, say, Forex, whatever it is, you might have called that a Bollinger mean reversion Forex, whatever you like. Once you type something in there, that creates the system. Okay. And then nominate whether you want to make it active or non-active. Now, active just means that when it comes into the compiler, it'll be flagged. We can turn it on or off in the compiler. It's not essential to have this on or off at this stage. It's just a handy little toggle, which I just set to active once I've set it up. Archive, when you obviously you might want to store a system that you don't want to be active, you just click on archive if you want it simply to be held in the database, but you don't necessarily want to refer to it again. Of course, later you can change that back to active, but that's just a method I use for toggling on or off. So once I've created the system list, let's say we want to go into the individual strategies contained within my Forex listing. So I simply double click on here and you'll see that the top section of the system details screen gives you an overview of the broad elements of the system. And so in this case, we're talking about our ATS stage process Forex. When it was created, if I want to make it effective at a particular point in time, not an essential date reference tool to use here, but I find it's handy to use. And then this is just a description, as long as you like. This is it's not a closed field, so we can type as much as we like in here. This gives a brief overview of what that system's about. And I've written here that this is our in-house proprietary workflow process used to develop trend-following diversified systematic portfolios. This process includes two trend-following models, the DOM and the MAT-SL, which our members will know about. They're a donkey and breakout system and a moving average crossover trend entry technique. So in effect, with these models, we've got these two breakout components in there. When I now look at what are the particular systems contained within this overall system data, what are the strategies? You'll see that I've got 24 different strategies here. These reflect 24 different markets that we have this system applied for. You can see markets are all specified down here from AUD JPY right down to natural gas, which is classified by Pepperstone as a Forex instrument because it's against the spot currency of USD. So this is crude oil. This is natural gas. This is palladium. This is gold. This is silver. Then the common Forex pairs, USD, JPY, etc. So in here,
to add a new one, you just do the same thing. You just fill in the fields.
Just click here to make this one active. Then give it a magic number for this particular system. In other words, we want to give a unique reference to this particular strategy. It might have multiple EAs within the single strategy, but we want to give it a unique reference number. So in this case, I might give it a number 2020. The system will warn you if you're reusing the number and won't allow you to reuse a number, but it's allowed me to enter that 2020 unique reference number. And then here, what I want to do is I want to give it, let's say this was, let's say this was platinum. So I'm trying to think, XP, I don't know what the code is.
Yeah, I get the gist. I think the guys can work that in.
You get the drift. So you set it up here. This is on a D1 time frame. You put in the effective dates. Now, what we do, just to come back to the...
Isn't like the fact we use 2020 because you already had that.
There you go. So it's forcing me to use a different number. So that's just a little... I'm just going to close this off.
Yep.
I'll give it 4564. I'll give it a new number now. I'm just going to delete it. Okay, so I've just deleted that back off. Now, in relation to the overall system, this is where we store our attachments for this system. And if I double click on that, you'll see that I'm storing information from a variety of different sources. I'm attaching all of my algorithms. The EX4 algorithms for this stage process, this entire stage process, in here, so we can retrieve the algorithms directly from here. So in other words, once they're in the database, you don't need to keep them separately in your file management system. It's here within the database. And if I, for instance, wanted to, can you see my little file manager screen I've just pushed up here, Fred?
No, it's just come up as a grey box.
Okay, so what I'm going to do is, what I will do is I'm going to send all of these attachments directly into my downloads section of my file manager. To do that, I simply go save oil, and then specify that I want to go into my downloads section. I go select, and then that therefore pastes that all of the contents that are in that attachments listing. If I go to my download, you'll see them here. I've got all of my different EAs. I've got all of my outputs from the strategy tester.
You might need to drag that onto the screen.
Okay. Let's see if I share screen.
Yeah, I'm getting that grey box again. But I did see when you were saving it, we did see that downloads page. Oh, there we go. We got it now. Yep.
Can you see all of the download files there?
Yep, see them all now.
Okay, so look, I'll just go back to where we were. Where are we? Just make sure this brings you back to the database. Can you see the database again?
Yep, okay.
Okay, so this is where you can store whatever you like associated with this particular system. And to do that, you just click on this Add button, and then you look for where the file is located in your directory structure. And you drag it, you just click it and select it, and it brings it in. And it stores it within the database itself. So I've got all of my particular files generated from my MT4 strategy tests of my algorithms for each of these particular strategies, as well as the algorithms themselves are located in here. That's in this section here.
Yep, got all that. Excellent.
So if I come to my individual strategies, I've also got another area for attachments which are specific to the actual strategy themselves. So I've got five attachments here that are specific to AUD-JPY. If I double click on that, you'll see that I've loaded the outputs generated from our in-house system for AUD-JPY here. Yes. So this is all of our outputs. So it's a very handy, this database is very handy to store everything you need in relation to that strategy. Once you've got it in here, you'll never forget it. It's always here and it can be retrieved again in a very easy way. And I'll show you how to do that. Before I do though, let's drill down to the next level. So at the moment we're at the individual strategy level here with 24 strategies. If I double click on this, I'm now brought down to the strategy itself. So in this case, it's AUD-JPY. I can see if I click into the attachments, this is the five attachments that I've created for my AUD-JPY. I've got notes here if I need it. But here I've got the trade history that we have brought into the database from your code supplement that has been described in that prior video we've already talked about.
Very good.
So that's all the details for AUD-JPY. Now, once all of that information is in there, we are then in a capacity. So I'll go into the, we can directly go to the strategy list here, which gives us all of the strategies we've created. So in this case, we've got 56 strategies housed in our database, and we can double click to get to the details of the strategy here. These are different views, effectively, of the same thing we've just gone through.
Yep.
The trade history, this gives us all of the trade history that's been stored in our database for all of our strategies. So in this case, we've got 13,000 records here. We can output this directly into Excel, or we can use the filter functionality in here to restrict our list to whatever we like. So let's say that I want, what can I do here? Well, you can filter by anything. You can filter in terms of quarters, months, whatever. Whatever you like to do, you can filter this data.
Does it give us the instrument?
The instrument itself, I'll show you how to get that. We get that from our compiler series. But what you can do here, I'll just see what we've got. Oh, I might have hidden some fields here. Trade ID. We actually don't have reference to the specific instrument here, but I'll show you how to quickly get it from our compiler.
I'm not sure why you'd want to interrogate this.
Well, you don't. You don't. It's just a method to do it if you wanted it.
Yeah.
So what I'll do now is, now that we see, okay, this is how we therefore include the details of all of our strategies within here. Let's go to the compiler and start identifying some of that past information that we might want to use for a portfolio. So when I go to the compiler section, we'll see three different screens here. The screen here that I'm just highlighting in these rows here, this relates to the result of the compiler itself, what will be compiled together as an output. Over here, with these particular screens over here, this is how I can reduce the number that are displayed in this compiler. So in this case, I've selected all of my systems here, but in this case I just, for instance, want to look at my Forex to compile. So I'll turn off my CFDs, I'll turn off my cryptos, turn off my indices, I'll turn off my SQX results. So in this case I'll turn off my mean reversion because I haven't actually created any strategies with that. That was just an example I gave to you of how we create it. In fact, I might go back and delete that. I'll quickly go back and delete that. Farewell. So let's now go back to the compiler. Okay, so I therefore want to just see all of the systems that are within my 4X classification of my ATS stage process. When I hit the refresh button, you'll see that now I've restricted my list down to 24 markets here. If I wanted to include, for instance, the outputs of 4X generated from my SQX workflow process, I'd click this in addition to clicking this. So I've got two selected now, both the 4X for the SQX outputs as well as the 4X for the in-house program. Hit refresh.
You clicked the archive button rather than...
Hit refresh. Thanks for that, Fred. You can see we've now got 36 strategies in here. That's therefore including both systems content. But in this case, I just want my in-house process. So here I've got 24. Now, in the compiler, what it does is it takes that trade history that's been loaded in and it consolidates it. So in here we can see that for this particular market, which is AUD JPY, I've got 95 trades. AUD USD, 101 trades. You can basically sort these fields, if you like, from largest to smallest. And most trades are coming from silver. The least trades are coming from natural gas. In this instance here, I can sort by compound annual growth rate. My best performance is from silver. My worst performance is from natural gas. I can sort by the probability of a win. For instance, you'll see all of these trend following systems are less than 50%, which is commonplace for us. We tend to have a very high average win against that average loss, but correspondingly we have a lower probability of win. We can see our average win here against our average loss. We can see that our average win is much higher than our average loss, which is in accordance with the positive skew that we've got within our trend following systems. We've got our net profit result, gross profit result. You can see, thanks to your coding, Fred, we can now separate how much is the swap component in that particular strategy for that particular backtest. We can see the spread component, the swap component, any commissions. So we've got information here we can sort by or filter by or whatever to reduce our listing if we wanted to.
How do you reduce the listing? What do you do?
Okay, so let's say we want a probability of greater than 30%. So all I do is I come into num and I go greater than and I go 0.3. 17 now. It's just restricted the list to everything greater than 30%.
Yep.
I can toggle that on, clear filter from PWin or whatever, toggle on, toggle off. I can sort however you like here. I can do date references, whatever. Now, up here, this is a date reference that basically determines the date of the trades that are available in our compiler. So at the moment, we can see that we've got 1,966 trades because I put a date reference here from the 1st of January 1985 to current day, effectively 28th of February 2021. But let's say I want to reduce this to 1st of the 1st 2015 because with our recency tests, we tend to take the last 5 years or so to look at the recency impact of our adaptable component of our portfolio. If I hit refresh here, you'll see that it then restricts the trades to within that date reference. So here we've now got 387 trades for that particular date reference. So this test start and test end field tells us what date range we've got available for from our entire data series contained in the database. And then this min date and max date tells us for this particular date range. You should see a spreadsheet now.
Yep, got it.
Tell me if you see the database if I bring it over here. Can you see it now?
Yep.
Ha ha! Okay, I've worked that out. That was a Skype issue. All right, so first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to clear the data that's in my compiler by clicking that button, clear data. Boom, that says hasta la vista to any previous data in there. And also I'm going to go to my returns dump tab. I've got these tabs down the bottom and hit clear data. So what I've done is I've just cleared any prior portfolio compilation process that I've done within this spreadsheet. I then return to my database. Now let's say that I'm happy with this listing and I now want to compile this grouping of 4x into a portfolio. I'll hit this button here and I've got the date range, 1st of January 2015 to 28th of February. I can make this as long as I like. Let's go 1st of the 1st, 1985. Let's do a long range one here. So we've got 1,945 trades here over that date range. You can see that my min date is around 1985, 86. Some of them it's not. Actually, let's do it over a common date range. So I go 1st of the 1st, let's say 2004. Okay, 1,022 trades, and we can see that min date is all around 2004 for every instrument. I'll accept this one here. Let's get rid of this instrument. This is AUD USD. Let's say hasta la vista to that from the compiler.
Pound Aussie.
Pound Aussie.
Third one down.
Let's say goodbye to that one. Just press it, mate. Okay, so we're happy with that. They're the instruments we want to compile.
Yeah.
I then hit this button, Portfolio Analytics Dump. Once I hit that, it then produces this output file, which I simply click on the left up the top here, where I am there, highlights a whole lot. I then copy that to my clipboard just by pressing Control-C or copy. Then what I do is I come to my spreadsheet. I go to my Analytics Dump tab. I then click in that very first row, A7, that gray row there, hit Control V, which pastes that result. Oops, sorry, I've just got to go back and copy that again. Press Control C, over here. Now, Control V will paste that into the spreadsheet. It's just doing it now, is it thinking? There we go, so it's pasted that data in there. Now what I also want is this further file, which is called the Portfolio Returns Dump. I click on that, and once again, you'll see that in date order, this is a complete history of all of the trade history on a day-by-day basis for each of the different magic numbers of the system. And you can see it's quite a big file. What I'm going to do is I'm going to highlight the entire file here, Control-C. Let's put it into memory, come back to here, go to the returns dump. In this gray cell here, which is F7, I'm going to go Control V. I'm going to paste that entire output into this spreadsheet. It's just working on it now, almost there. Okay, it's now pasted. So I've got all of my outputs from my database that I want to look at how to compile this into an effective optimized portfolio. I can then look at the results from the raw portfolio stage, which is simply what is the raw result without any treatment of that entire compiled series. Now, we won't spend much time on this because this isn't the important tab. This is just what the results are currently saying at the moment for a $50,000 portfolio. We want to get to this tab, the risk weight portfolio. Now, what this does is this starts to, it risk weights every one of these strategies. These are the individual strategies. So in this case, we've got 21 different strategies. I'll just open this up a bit. So we've got AUD, JPY, all of the ones down here. This is their raw drawdown, how they've been taken over into the portfolio. But what I want to do now is I want to make each drawdown equivalent to a roundabout a max drawdown of 10%. So in this cell here, I apply 10%, and then what it will do is it will then apply a multiplier to therefore convert its drawdown for this result into something as close to 10% as it can get. And you can see that it's fairly close to 10% for each of the systems. It's either slightly below or slightly above. This is now risk-weighted, everything in accordance with the maximum drawdown over its history.
And it's achieved that by altering the lot size.
Correct. So this multiplier here applies to the lot sizing down here of the risk weight of the raw portfolio and then adjusts it accordingly. So this is now a risk-weighted portfolio. Now, so what that does then is says, all right, now it's risk-weighted it. Let's have a look at our portfolio compiler and see if we can get it any better. So when we come to the portfolio compiler, sorry, I'll go to here, the summary sheet here. If we look at the summary sheet that I've just clicked on here, you'll see the results of the raw portfolio, which is what we've just taken over without any treatment. You can see that we have a 2% compound annual growth rate. We've got a 3% drawdown. That's no good for us. We want something that fits our risk tolerance. So we set our individual strategy max drawdown to 10%, and it produces for the entire portfolio an overall max drawdown of 12% in our risk-weighted portfolio result, which is something that we can tolerate.
Sorry, mate, you called that drawdown, but it's actually CAGR.
Sorry, mate, good point. Here we go. Drawdown here, 60%. That's far too much for us, but that is the result of how the risk weight portfolio currently works. If each of our individual systems are around 10%, our total portfolio pulls in at a 60% drawdown. Now, that is a problem. What this means to us is that we need to scale down the result. But we'll do that at the end of the exercise, and I'll show you how we do it. But just remember, at the moment, our drawdown is too high. 60% is too high. But the first thing we do when we come to the portfolio compiler is we want to eliminate any of these strategies that have negative skew. We've discussed this in prior podcasts, but I want to now, I see here, we've got two strategies here with negative skew. I want to get rid of them from my portfolio. So I simply put a one in here. That turns that strategy off from our portfolio. So I've now turned off any strategy that is contributing negative skew to the portfolio. And you can see now that two systems have been eliminated from my portfolio result. Now, what I can do is, in a similar way, I can look at the MAR, the risk-weighted MAR, down here and turn on or off any of the systems down this column by putting a 1 in this area, but at the moment I'm happy with everything. You can eliminate things that are overly correlated using the correlation result down here by looking at, this particular strategy has a 0.55 correlation to the overall portfolio, which might be too high, depending on how we see it. If we wanted to turn that off, hit 1 in that column, turns it off. But I'm going to keep that on for the moment because we've got a different way for this particular portfolio compiler of compiling, and I'll show you how we do that. But here in this compiler, we can turn on or off any strategies and see what the result is from the impact of us turning it on or off. But what I want to do is come to here, equity curves for compilation. So at the moment, we've turned off 2, and in total, we have 21. So that's 19 strategies in total that are alive still. Let's go to our equity curves. So you'll see here that up the top section, this section here, we are reflecting the portfolio result as it currently stands after our treatment from the portfolio compiler phase. So in this case, we so far are sitting at a max drawdown of 60%, a compound annual growth rate of 12%, and a MAR ratio of 0.21. That is represented by the entire portfolio, which is at the top here. From this section going down, we've got every equity curve of every individual strategy within that system that is turned on currently. So you know that we had, I think, 19 or so strategies we kept on after the portfolio compiler phase. These are the results of their equity curves. This has been turned off, this one here. That's why you can't see anything. And this one has been turned off. You can't see anything here. But these are our individual strategy results. So depending on how you want to do this, this is how I do it, how I compile my portfolio. The first thing I do is I align these red lines here to where my maximum drawdown on my portfolio is. So here, I'll align it to this point here. Now, this is simply the same thing for this portfolio, but I've got it in columns. So I align this to that same period here. I align that to there. I align that to there. Now, the first thing I want to do is I want to reduce that awful drawdown that we see right up the front. Because at the moment, you notice how we had a 60% drawdown. That's because we had very correlated series early on in the history of this five-year result for this portfolio. So in this case, what are the ones contributing to that drawdown? You can clearly see that this contributes to that drawdown because the equity curve gets to a low point here. You can clearly see that this also, this strategy here, contributes to that drawdown with the equity curve. This one hasn't done much. This one is slightly coming up. This is coming up, so that's fine. So I know visually from how this column has stood up that this is a particular strategy I might want to turn off. So let's look at the impact by looking at where we are currently. So for this compiled series, I've got a 50, so we've got 19 instruments currently. We've turned a few off already. But this is the drawdown we've got at the moment, 52.16. I want to turn off this instrument and see if I significantly improve the MAR ratio by turning this off. Hit one there, because visually I can see it's contributing to the portfolio result. Now let's turn it off. Take a while to just update. So you can see now that the drawdown has dropped. By turning that off to 42.76, we've got 18 instruments by turning that off. The MAR has come up to 0.29. So now what I might want to do is turn off another one. So let's have a look at the impact now. It's still at the highest point here. So let's turn off another that's contributing obviously to that drawdown. So let's look at this one over here. This one over here is contributing definitely to a drawdown, as is this one. So what I'll do is I'll turn this one off and I'll see the impact. At the moment we're at 0.29 MAR. I'm just going to see, by turning this off we've got a 0.36 MAR, a much better result. But let's look at, by turning that back off again, go back to where I was, 0.29, let's look at the impact of this one, turning this one off. 0.30, I've got a much better impact by turning off the other one. So let's turn off this one. So 0.36 MAR. You can see now that my drawdown is significantly reduced. I should now be able to eliminate those that are contributing to these drawdowns here by just having a look at a few more. Let's have a look at clear obvious ones. Here's one. Let's knock this one out. So remember, we're at 0.36 MAR up here. Let's turn this one off. 0.39 MAR. I've improved my MAR a bit and the drawdown's come down. So now I'm at the 31% drawdown. As you can see, also what I might do is I might get rid of any equity curve that looks really ugly. So look, I don't like this equity curve because this shows that we've got a bit of a risk weakness in the system. This one, we had a big drop here. I'm going to turn this one off, see if that improves the MAR. At the moment, we're at 0.39. I've turned that one on. No change to the MAR. So when I get no change, I revert. I get it back in because from principles of diversification, you want as many diversified options as you can in here. What we are effectively doing here a bit is curve fitting to a degree. But as you can see, what I've been doing here is curve fit from a risk treatment phenomenon. So I eliminated those with negative skew because they can contribute to risk weakness of the portfolio. When we come to the compiled portfolio here for our Forex instruments, at the moment we're just dealing with our Forex compilation. Now I'll be doing the same exercise for my CFD compilation and my indices. They'll give further diversification, but what I want to do here is just eliminate those that are particularly correlated from a visual method that contribute to those drawdowns. So at the moment, I could turn off some more and see if it improves the result, but I tend to think that is curve fitting. So what I'll do now is I'll come to my summary of where I'm at now. So we started with our raw portfolio. We then came to our risk treated portfolio of 21 instruments where we had a drawdown of 60%. We now are at a position where our drawdown is now down to 31%. We've got a CAGR of 12% and a much better MAR of 39%. So I might want to reduce that drawdown further. And the way I do that is I come to my portfolio compiler and I will increase my total equity allocated to this portfolio. So over here, we see a max drawdown of 31%. Let's now use a capital amount of 75,000. You can see now I've diluted my drawdown to 21%. So if I wanted a drawdown of around 25% with the treatment I've done so far to this portfolio, I'd need to trade this with about $75,000 capital. So there you go, mate. That's how I compile using this particular portfolio compiler. It's different to the compiler our members are used to with Quant Analyzer, which is another way of compiling, which is a very effective way. But I do like this method. And the good thing about this method is that members don't need to buy Quant Analyzer if they want to use this method. This is all available to them. They can use our in-house MetaTrader 4 programs for their workflow process, and they can use this as a method of compiling at the end. But also, this whole portfolio compiler itself should be something that they start getting all of their strategies into, basically just to organize themselves better and to be able to reuse old work from the past and never lose it. So any thoughts, mate?
I think that's all fairly clear. What I think you might want to elaborate on is, now that you've done your compilation, what do you do with it? How do you trade this?
So what I'd do now is I'd come to, once I've dealt with this, I'd then come to my risk weight here. I'd look at, what I know, for instance, in this particular portfolio, if I wanted to compile this as a portfolio, I'd simply come to here and I'd see, all right, now what I want to do is I want to, all of these that have still turned on, still producing a result, are the ones I therefore want to consider for my portfolio. But then what I'd use is, in my algorithms, I would actually, rather than use a fixed lot sizing here, I'd apply a percent trade risk lot sizing to each of these, say 0.5% trade risk or 1% trade risk applied to these portfolios, because this will scale them in the same way I've just risk weighted scaled them using the drawdown in a very similar way. But it'll tell me which of the algorithms to use to eliminate any strongly correlated series or those with negative skew.
So you would just use a percentage rather than some weighting factor?
Well, at the moment, when for instance, I pulled this information into this database here, I'll just go back to it. If I go to the trade history, to do like-for-like for this Forex universe, I've dealt with them all at a 0.01 lot size, every single one of them. But in practical terms, when I'm actually trading this, I'd be using a percent trade risk calculation on my equity, as we're familiar with. What that does is, like our risk weighting scenario, it scales them to the volatility. It's a bit different to the drawdown. We're scaling to the drawdown, but what we'd be doing with a trade risk percentage is scaling them to the volatility and normalizing volatility across the entire Forex series. I'd use the compiler to identify which ones I want in my final portfolio, and then when I apply to my live or my demo trading environment, I'd then use those algorithms but apply the trade risk percentage technique.
I mean, what about, could you backtest this then? What would you do there?
Yeah, so I'll give an example of a backtest. What I'll do here is just show you how easy it is to get information in and out of this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to backtest. I'll go back to my strategy list, systems list here. I'm going to get my Forex universe. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to backtest EURUSD and update the data. So this is the data associated with this test here. Now, let's say this is a stagnant result that's only maybe 5 years old. I want to update this result. So what I'll do is I'm going to delete the trade history by just clicking here. So I've just deleted the trade history of EURUSD. Now I want to undertake the back test again for EURUSD using our in-house algorithm. So as our members know, it's a stage 5 algorithm. And what it is using is it's using our stage 4 output. So if I go to my stage 4 output in the trader, you've got to load the EURUSD stage 4 output, which you'll see in our ATS directory here. So in this case, this particular trader is using a Donkian breakout and the moving average crossover trend following technique. We've got three Donkian breakout algorithms in this particular sub-portfolio. We've got two moving average crosses. Here are the settings here for our Donkian period, and here are the settings here for our moving average crossovers. So that's the algorithm I want to use, which is from our in-house process. I now want to conduct a back test to update the portfolio compiler with most recent data. So I'll put it on visual because we all like looking at visual. When I come to expert properties here, I'm now, fortunately I took the password off so no one can see the password, but that is available to our members when they come in here. But what you want to do is select fixed lot size of 0.01 for Forex. If it's indices, it's 0.1. If it's CFDs, you use one lot. But anyway, you'll get to understand that when you look at the market specification symbols of MetaTrader. If I go, for instance, here to the specification, you'll see that the minimum lot is 0.01. That's what I want to use for this back test. So what I'm going to do, Fred, is I'm just going to put our password in. I'm going to use the 0.01 lot here. I'm going to also tick record all trade history and set it to true. Okay, so now I'm going to put my password in. No one can see that, I hope. Now we're ready to go, and I'm going to run the back test. I'll slow it down a bit so people can see it actually in action. So this is, we'll all be familiar with this. This is our EURUSD algorithm that we generated from our in-house process. It's a nice long trade here.
The other thing to remember here is that this is the result of that process. So if you're doing this in a year's time or 2 years' time, you may want to reevaluate your total strategy run again rather than just automatically using an older compilation.
Absolutely. So what I'll do is I'll just speed this up now to get a result at the end. See how our equity curve is going. It's going quite well.
Rich, I'm going to be annoying here, but I have to take a phone call.
You want to keep talking? Phone call and I'll keep talking.
Thank you.
So the back test is carrying along nicely. It's almost finished. Okay, so we've now got a completed result. Now what we want to do is get those results that we've generated in our trade history folder. So to do that, we showed you in the prior video, you come to File, Open Data Folder, and you come to Tester, you come to Files, you come to ATS. This is it. This is the file we've created called Ultimate History. We open this up. So here is a trade history of this particular backtest that I now want to take to my portfolio compiler. To do that, what I've got to do is, firstly, I've got to use my import spreadsheet that is part of the download kit that's provided to our members. And the first thing I want to do is, I'll just set this up here. I'll come back to my compiler. I'll see that I've named my EURUSD with a unique number of 2009. So what I want to do in my compiler is I want to set this to, firstly, I want to clear all previous data. I want to set it to 2009. I want to show that it has actually come from a back test. I also want to give the name of the broker, which is Pepperstone. I also want to show that it's using open prices only, and I want to use my initial opening balance, which is 50,000, which I'm going to place in here. So now that's all set up. Now I can accept the data that has been created from that history file by simply going to the first row of data, highlighting all of the data here, copying it, and then coming to my import spreadsheet, and in cell A14, simply pressing Control V or paste. That then pastes the data in a particular format that can be accepted by the database. So over here in blue is the data that we want to take now to the database. So I highlight the entire range of data that I want to take to the database. The backtest. I come now back to the portfolio compiler. I now want to update this data in this particular strategy, 2009, by highlighting the first row, pressing Control V, and the data is now back in. So now, if I go to my compiler, it will update with that most recent data. So let's go to the compiler, come here, press refresh, EURUSD, which is now, let's find out where it is, there it is, has now been updated with that data that I've now updated. So that's how you get the data into the compiler, and how we, in this instance, use this data then to compile our portfolio. So that's it in a nutshell for our compiler. We can also, of course, do this now with our strategy quant outputs. So if I go into the strategy quant outputs, for instance, this strategy here, this is for our CFDs. And in this case, I've got cocoa, coffee, cotton, soybeans, sugar for our CFDs. You'll see that in my attachments, I've loaded my MetaTrader strategy tester results in here, but also the actual workflow process files, the configuration files for the workflow processes for this particular system is all loaded here. And when I come to the individual strategies themselves, you'll see that in the attachment section, I've loaded all of my output files from Strategy Quant X, which is the Strategy Quant X files of the strategies and the portfolio or sub-portfolio expert advisors that we generate within Strategy Quant after having tested it within the MetaTrader platform. So that's now in here, also as attachments, and we've got all of the data loaded into here using the code insert that has been discussed on a prior video that we insert into our Strategy Quant MetaTrader 4 quotes. That's in there. So that's how we get our information in from Strategy Quant. So you can see that our compiler is a very powerful tool, very useful as a one-stop shop for all of our strategies, and it allows us to revisit things at a later date and just keep on top in a very organized way, keep on top of our processes, and just make sure that we've got the capacity to compile our portfolios however we see fit. So, look, I don't think Fred's going to be able to make it back. I think he's still on a telephone call. But, look, I hope you enjoyed this video, and stay safe, and we'll see you shortly with another video using how to use the Algo Wizard function of Strategy Quant X. So we hope you enjoyed this video, and our members, you'll be able to find this version 3 of the compiler in the download section of the forum, which we'll include straight after we've posted this particular this video onto our channel. So thanks everyone, and stay safe and trade well and prosper. Bye.